Thank you for tuning in to our Morning Glory live stream. So this was going to be the it for the day. And today's title is going to be, Whose Fool Are You? Whose Fool Are You? And what we're going to talk about today, we're going to talk about people who are literally making a fool out of people, whether it's in life, whether it's in especially in ministry and relationships. We are so bound into wanting and needing people that we often overlook the things that show us that these people are no good for us. We're going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We're going to start at verse 1. But the most pivotal, or I think the most important scripture in 2 Corinthians 10 is verse 12. So we're going to get down to that. But verse 12 just say, "For we dare not make ourselves of the number, or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves by they measure themselves by themselves, and compare themselves among themselves, and not why." See, we're going to talk about fools. We're going to get down to that scripture. Y'all know how I am. I like to start right at the meat, and sometimes I might start in the middle. But we got to understand that we can no longer, we're coming into a season that we can no longer be fooled by people. Either you in ministry or you're not in ministry. Either you're trying to be in ministry or you're not trying to be. Time out for all these social media hooligans that come talking about, I study at the school of the Holy Spirit. Listen here, all through the Bible, no matter who you see, they all had some kind of mentor, or they had some kind of connection that they was able to be held accountable to them. And the strange thing is, we see that in the Bible, we are fooled because we let people just run around doing anything just because they say they're anointed. We listen to anything just because they talking about they heard from God. The reason the church is in the state that it's in is because most believers that sits on the pew, they do not have their own personal relationship with God. And not only that, most of the time, they're hearing from a carnal and fleshly manner in which they think it's God and it's not God. 2 Corinthians 10 verse 1 says, "Now I Paul myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am based among you, but being absent I'm bold towards you." So what Paul did in the first Corinthians, he's established his independence. Not only was he established independence, he was established his independence and his spiritual nature in Christ. That's why he said by the meekness and gentleness of Christ. See, sometimes we are preaching, people think they all hard and all that, but we're not. But what Paul was doing since he was writing, he said, "Let me show you who I am or who I try to be." We all not perfect. You get what I'm saying? We get that. We all mess up sometimes. We get that. But at the same time, if you want to be a leader coming to preach the gospel or preaching the gospel, you got to show your meekness in Christ. So when he goes on and says, "Who impressed, I'm base among you, but being absent, I'm bold towards you." What base means is equal. He was telling them, when I come to you or when I'm around you, I want you to treat me like you treat each other, or I treat you like I treat myself. He was saying in his eyes they all equal. But he know when he left, sometimes, and y'all know, y'all do it now, when the pastor leaves, some of y'all don't even go to church, or y'all just do anything. But when that pastor or that prophet there, y'all just be sitting there, okay. So what he was saying, by saying I'm bold towards you, he was saying when he leave and has to write a letter or send a message back to the church, he was saying, you sense me being more, what's the word I want to use? He using another level of power that he usually don't use when he's with them. That's just like sometimes you'll teach people because you understand their spirits. But a lot of time when you lead people, they do so much things because you ain't around. You got to speak with another level of authority so they understand that they understand that, hey, you know I'm called to teach you. You know I'm called to help you. You know I'm called to mentor you. And that's where a lot of us mess up at. We go look for people who already established, who are already out there, and we think they called to be our mentor. So we'll write them a letter and ask them to send us this and send us that. And we now this person saying they mentoring you or they're teaching you, and the only time you hear from it is when they want some money. We don't do that. Verse 2 said, "But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some which think of us as we walk according to the flesh." All verse 2 was saying, sometimes you got to tell somebody off. So what he was saying, he said, that I may not be bold when I'm present with that confidence. He said, when I'm with you, I don't want to use a certain level of authority or a certain level He don't want to use a certain level of authority or a certain voice when with you, because I want to make sure, watch this, that we stay on friendly terms. I want to make sure the door open that you can come say something to me anytime. Y'all got these leaders, they get through preaching, they get them four big old ugly men or women stand up over there and they run in the back. They don't shake your hand. They don't ask how you doing. They don't know if you look good. They run in the back either getting ready for the next serve or they go out the back door and go home. That's not a leader. I told you now, a leader should know the state of affairs of everyone in his care. That's a leader. All right, so when he said, which think of us, we walk according to the flesh, that means some people going to think that you're prideful or you're arrogant by the way they may see you when you present the gospel. So what Paul was saying in verse 2, he said, sometimes people that don't know you, you got to tell them off. I have to tell a lot of people off. You might see me on social media, on Facebook, Twitter. I may say things, and it may come across as arrogant or prideful, but if my wife were here or some of the friends here, they'll tell y'all if they're around, I'm sitting here on the computer, I be laughing half the time with stuff I say, even though it's true, because I know people gonna get mad. You know why? Because it's the truth. People really scatter the truth because they understand when you hear the truth, it gonna make you change. So they rather live a lie than accept the truth. That's why a lot of people are going through hell now. They don't want to accept the truth. They live in a lie, but every time something bad happened to them, they want to say it's the devil. How come it can't be God trying to correct you, trying to turn you around? We got to understand, don't be no fool just because you like what you like. Yeah, you like screwing, but you can't go through all your life screwing because you know it's wrong. Yeah, you like stealing, but you can't go through your life stealing. You like lying and backbiting. But then when somebody say a message about, watch this, this is a funny thing about people. When somebody say something that convicts them, they'll stop listening to the video or they'll stop following talking to them because now they're convicted. If you're around me, you're going to be convicted a lot of times. Ahead of time, some things I say, I convict myself. Verse 3 said, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. What Paul was saying, see, church folks like to use that scripture. We walk in the flesh, we don't war. What Paul was saying, he said, even though I walk as a natural man, I don't go after the thing that pleases a natural man. If you get through preaching, you still gotta have your shot till you get drunk. You in the flesh. If you get through preaching, you still got to go over your girlfriend's house and get you a little bit, you in the flesh. If you get through preaching, you still got to go gossip of what Sister May had on or what Brother Henry said or how he looked at Sister May. And boy, I used to go to this church, boy. It'd be so funny. So I know the boy and the girl was kind of talking. So I was in the parking lot at the church. It was so funny because the girl was coming out and she had the back door open. He ran and jumped in the car with his head down because he want nobody to know that he was going over the girl out to spend a few days over there. And they seen me. I ain't say nothing. You know, I just laughed and gave the thumbs up. Listen here. I learned a long time ago, if you sneak to do something, that's when you get caught. If you go ahead and do it, you'll get caught, but you won't be get caught as somebody seeing it as obvious. So I learned, if I'm going to do something wrong, I'm just going to do it because people looking. They looking. So if you're going to sneak. So our verse 3 said, if you're going to walk in the power authority of God, it shouldn't be so easy for you to cuss. It shouldn't be so easy for you to lie. I see a lot of people, especially on social media, they lying their tails off just to get money from people. Because the people following, they done became a fool. Don't be a fool. Verse 4 says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down the stronghold. That means, see, watch how he said that right after war of the flesh. That means if you know you're trying to live right for Christ, and something that's not in the mind of Christ happened to you, instead of dwelling on it, you got to pull that thing down. Tell that spirit of fornication it got to go. Lesbianism, whatever y'all call it, whatever you in, tell it got to go. Poverty, you got to go. You get what I'm saying? You can't sit around, ooh, well, I'm gonna pay my card. No, I guess I'm gonna be broke. That's why you broke. Number one, you ought to get a car that you can afford. Number two, not only get a car you can afford, you should have kept riding the bus till you know that you can afford a car. See, that was wrong with black folks. They love to get stuff to show that God blessing them, and they can't even keep what he giving them. Or they'll tell you, oh, these glasses cost $400. I paid $60 for this hat. I paid such and such. They love to tell you how much something costs. Be up all night. I don't know how I'm going to pay this light bill. I don't know what I'm going to do with this water bill. I don't know. Don't be no fool. Listen here. You rather suffer in the will of God than get something and say it from God and can't afford it. I tell people all the time, if you struggling with something, just give the devil his stuff back. Because if you're going to live a life of Christ, Christ or God is never going to give you anything that you got to struggle and keep. I don't care how fine she is, how fine he is, how much money they make, what kind of car it is. If you struggling in any area of life, that's not God. Because watch this, you already got a spiritual trial. Why he would send you through a natural trial? God ain't gonna put more on you with better. And so the most of your natural trial come because your spirit is not poor, because you trying to buy something you know you can't afford. I see people that go out here and buy all kind of couples for their you know, you tell the truth when you start to call. They go get all kind of different color covers for their phone. All different kind of color glasses. Eating out all week. But then when the bill come, I don't know how I'm going to pay it. You'd have probably spent $200-$300 on nothing. On nothing. Watch this. You only buy other stuff when you can afford what you got. My son's sitting there right now. He wanted some racetrack cost $30. Then he seen he liked them Thomas train. He sees something. That thing was $100. I told him, Mom, I said, ooh, he might not get that one. See, that's my mind. It wasn't that I couldn't afford it. I said, ooh, that's a lot of money. But I told him what he can do. He did it. Yeah, I went and got it. But watch this. When I went to the store to get it, it wasn't $100. Well, I seen it for $79 online at Toys R Us. We went to the store, it was still $100. I said, hey, it's $79 on your website. They got me now. I'm telling you, they got me. But sometimes I got to stop doing it. Sometimes when you get me, I don't say nothing. I just go on out the store. So it was, so the promotion was, you can get the you can get the track and two free cars, which was like $25. That'd probably been like $100 and something. So it's okay, it's $79, but if you get it for $79 and we price match it, you can't get the car. That's all right, that's fine. What I'm trying to say, if what somebody offering you don't match up or don't look right, why you getting it? You get what I'm saying? So these people telling you they got all this power in God, but when you call them, they can't speak a word and hear you. One of my friends came. She came back around, and I had been dealing with her and helping her. And then she had a friend who said wanted to talk to me today. He all right. He asked another question. He said, "Man, that makes sense. Thanks for helping me." Man was depressed. You know, spirit of condemnation all on him. You got to know that you're anointed to do so. Because one thing about me, if I can't do it, I ain't finna fake. That's why I don't know nothing about that. I know somebody who can, and I give you their number. A lot of people around here fake it. They ain't got the power, you know, they talk about. Because when you operate in real leadership, you know your limitations. So even though some people may say, "Ooh, Brother Hubbard, this and that," I know my limitation. I'm not finna teach or try to do nothing I can't do just to get more people so they can start giving me more money. That ain't worth a hill of beans. Verse 6 says, "And having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled." See, 5 and 6, they go together. They marry. So watch this. You want to go to God and say things to cast down stronghold, but you disobedient to his word. How you going to use his word to overcome and you ain't using his word to live? That's why y'all still going through stuff. And having the readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fair. He told you to give sister so-and-so $200. You ain't did it yet. Oh, but now something happened. Well, God, do this. And having the readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fair. What does that mean? That means 99.9% of y'all praying for God to do something for you, and you in disobedience. Obedience is better than sacrifice. See, when I pray to God for something, I ain't no fool. I look at my life and say, have I done everything that I thought God wanted me to do, what I thought I heard him do, or what I know was right? If it line up, okay, God, I need you to do this for me. Y'all walking in disobedience and thank you because some prophet spoke it over like that is going to happen. It ain't going to happen till when your obedience is fulfilled. The power of God is not going to work in your life till you obedient to the word. What I'm saying again, you got to be obedient to the natural world, and you don't even have to have a spiritual relationship with God to do that. I see people all on social media. I know their life tore. Well, God, I want you to do this. God, I want you to do that. God ain't going to do nothing till you obedient. I had to talk with my son. He came here crying yesterday because he ain't get no supper. I said, so Joey, you want the teacher to give you a sucker even though you was bad today? He said, yeah. That's how Christians is. I said, you can't get none if you bad. I said, oh, you got that train because you did what I told you to do. What I'm saying, y'all want God to do something for you, but you doing what you want to do. Y'all a fool. Don't be no fool. And the reason people doing that, because people can't take simple scripture and tell you, say, hey, God really not going to move in your behalf till you obey him. Y'all got to obey this word. That's when people come calling me. And they say something going wrong. I said, that's between you and God. Because some people you can't tell they ain't in the will of God because they say holy, all that. You can't tell them that. I got friends like that. I got kinfolks like that. They think they so holy. You can't tell them that because they know it all. That's why you struggling, because you operate in disobedience. But you want to think just because God tell you something that's going to happen. Man, y'all going on with that stuff. Verse 7, let me get off that soapbox. Don't be no fool. Do you look on things after the outward appearance? If any man trusts to himself that he is Christ, let him of himself think this again, that as he is Christ, even so are we Christ. Stop running around here and calling people witches, warlocks, and demons. Just because what they look like on the outside or what they may portray, like I tell everybody, they still a child of God. Yeah, he shot Trayvon Martin, but my question is he still a child of God? Yeah, they killing black people left and right, but they still a child of God. Why? Because everything belong to God. Even though Satan may have used certain people to do certain things, they still a child of God. Can they be repent? So what Paul was saying in verse 7, he said, so you never messed up before? See, I had a problem with that. I see somebody doing something, I get so mad, and then God had to remind me what I used to do. So y'all walk around here, you witches this, you witches that. You operate in witchcraft. Some of y'all used to sell tail for money. Same thing, manipulation witchcraft. I give you some of this if you give me a few of them, what they call it, paying at the hole. Like you ain't never slept with nobody that was in church. Like you ain't never stole nothing. Like you ain't never got drunk as a skunk. So we got to stop thinking just because we got a little following, we get a few preaching engagement, we come on social media, look at them witches there, look at them warlocks there, and what are you? Verse 8, for though I should boast somewhat more of our authority, which the Lord hath given us for edification and not for your destruction, I should not be ashamed. So in verse 8, what Paul was saying, he said, yeah, I should tell you about the demons I done cast out. I should tell you about the deliverance that took place. I should tell you about the revelation we've seen, because we get that for edification and not for your destruction. For he said, but no, I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about how we treat one another. Verse 9, that I may not seem as if I would terrify you by letter. Verse 10 said, for his letters say they are weighty and powerful, but his bodily presence and weak, and his speech contemptible. So I remember when I first started, a lot of y'all who've been with me for a while, y'all remember when I first started ministry, I used to write a bunch of revelation. But people used to call me from all over town. Ooh, I just felt the power in that. And I was talking to one lady out of Mississippi. She said, when I read your letter, I sent it to such and such, such and such. By the time it came around, somebody all over in Illinois was reading a letter that I wrote way, I think I was in San Atlanta. What I'm saying, you can have anointing in your life that even you write a letter, you can see the power in it. So I did that for a while, but I did that because that's how God was speaking to me back then. Because he understood I wasn't comfortable doing videos or able to present myself. So he used to have me write them down. Man, I used to write some stuff. I think I'm going to get them all together and put them in a book. Yeah, I think I'd do that. I'm going to have to call it something. But I got plenty. I think I wrote letters maybe 2 or 3 years. If that much. So what it's saying, don't allow people to dictate your authority in the gospel. You need to have this, you need to have that, you need to have that. You get what God tell you to get. But then if you get around a mentor who has success in the gospel, I say, hey, you might need to want to do this, you might want to need to do that. Because I'm going to tell you everything that made me successful. You pray about it, and if God tell you do it, you do it. Verse 11 says, let such a one think this, that such as we are in word by letters when we are absent, such will we be also indeed when we are present. Paul was saying, not only can I write the word with power, he said, when I get in front of you, I show you power. He even be on Facebook talking about the glory falling here and the glory falling there. This took place and this took place. Then I go visit a church. I sit there for 2-3 Sundays in a row. Man, watch this. They don't start on time. They start an hour later. People, the darn music, they up there praying, the music louder than the prayer, so the prayer, they got to try to talk loud to hear, you don't even know what it's saying because the musician all up in there, and you only know the prayer, and everybody just saying amen. You got to know what you're saying amen too. Ain't no miracles telling. So I'm saying to myself, so this nigga on here, and that's what I said to myself, I said this nigga here perpetrating the fraud. Didn't that go on? And I show, yeah, I said something after the blow. I said, hey, man, you said your service started this time, and it started at this time because they were waiting on the leader. I told him then, I said, your church got a spirit of dependency. I said, if they got to wait on you to start, you ain't doing nothing. I said, you need to tell them. If you're a good teacher and leader, church shouldn't have to wait till the leader get in and it gets to start. They got to wait till the leader show up. I never go to a place like that. I went there for about 2 or 3 weeks and the same thing still happened. I knew then he was no real leader. Here you go, verse 12. For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves among themselves. Now why? That ain't no tongue twister. What Paul was saying, he said, don't make yourself a people who compare, don't make yourself the number of people who commend themselves. You know the type. Yeah, I went in there, them demons went to going. The demon went to flying. We the demon killing crew. Or they have some conference time, the apostles of God and all that mess. Paul said, don't you get around there like that. But they measure themselves by themselves, which means they got a circle to hang here. And everybody think they somebody and they ain't doing nothing. Or I hate when I do something, people will call, how much money you make, how much money you bring in. That ain't your business. You ain't giving none, so don't ask me how much I get. If I happen to come out through conversation, so be it. That still don't mean you're going to get some. He said, people ain't wise. So when you went around there and you see the same preachers and teachers and doing everything, God telling you through Paul's revelation, they ain't about nothing. Watch verse 13 tied up. But we will not boast of things without our measure, but according to the measure of the rule will God have distributed to us a measure to reach even unto you. The reason verse 12 tell you that's not why, because when you in the same circle with the same people, you ain't growing. That means the same people just coming to see the same people. That means you ain't reached nobody. Y'all hear me talk about Birmingham all the time. I said a couple years ago, I'm going to say it today. And if they watch it, so be it. You don't nobody out there feed me. I see the same flies with the same people going to the same place in Birmingham all the time. Where your reach at? This is like going around the mountain. If you got, listen here. You bring people in to the same place to say, and then they see them, then they get them to start doing. So they bringing people in the same place with the same people preaching the same. Well, they might not be preaching the same, but it's the same people. Well, let me get him because Apostle so and so had him, Sister so and so had him, and watch this. You going into the same place? Why you can't afford to take them nowhere else? Don't be no fool. Think that because these people got people around them that they ministry growing. Your ministry ain't going. That's a circle. They ain't doing that. So watch this. Because the Bible said don't build your ministry on another man's foundation. So if you got to call another preacher in to preach to bring in a crowd, that's that man foundation. That ain't yours because they come to hear whoever you bring in. They ain't come to hear you because when that person leaves, they gone. Be your ministry on your own night. I never, when I do something, I bring people in sometime. And that's for something else because God may say, hey, do this with this such and such. But you never see me having something most of the time and somebody else got to bring in a crowd. I bring in whoever here and believe in what I'm preaching. Verse 13. But we will not boast of things without our measure, but according to the measure of the rule that God has distributed to us, a measure to reach even unto you. So what Paul went on to say, he said, I reach you by what God gave me. If you got to keep bringing people in to preach for you, to reach people, then you ain't confident in your ministry. Use what God give you till you get more. Y'all want to go around here and pay people to come in because, ooh, they can draw a crowd. And they like, boy, I never forget that lady in Birmingham bunging, what's his name now? He lost weight. But it was two big names. I know one of them was sent, Bloomer and Trim. That lady spent all that money written about with a brain man, Bloomer and Trim. And the people didn't come like she expected. Everybody don't know Bloomin' Trim. So she had to cancel that and end up having it at the church. So I went around there because God sent me around there for a word of hope and do something else. I gave $100 because God told me, because they know I don't give with no money either. But what I'm saying is, why try to build your ministry up on another man's name or another man's anointing? What about yours? If you can't reach people with your own anointing, you ain't ready for ministry. It's so many people that are not ready for ministry. It's a shame, but they call themselves ministering because we got social media and Facebook. They'll see the way somebody else do their ministry, then they'll mimic it and start bringing in the same people, or and they call the minister. You ought to hear the horror stories I see that people say they called a minister and people that came in and told these people church up because they was not prayerful. They just knew them because somebody else knew them. You got to pray for you bring people in if that's what you're going to do. Trying to use other people's platform. I remember, I ain't going to talk about that. Verse 14, for we scratch not ourselves beyond our measure, as though we reach not unto you, for we are come as far as to you, also in preaching the gospel. That's critical in verse 14. For we stretch not ourselves beyond our measure. Look here. If you got to save money to have a conference, if you got to worry about what they're going to charge you, you ain't ready. These heathens will go out here and spend $700-$800 on a conference room that may sit 200-300 people, and they can't even get 20 good people in their house. Why would I go spend that money? Because you think people gonna come. You stretching yourself. Listen here. If you can't afford to do no flyer, don't do one. You gotta see the flyer that come through Facebook that look pathetic. I'd rather not do a flyer and just type something and send them out, then to do a flyer and see what it looked like. I'd rather not have a website than people take me to a website and it's all jacked up. People ain't gonna support your ministry when they see all that mess up there. Don't be no fool. I look at it. You better off saying, Brother Hubbard, I know you do such and such. I ain't got no money. Can you do this for me? I'll pay you later. One or two things gonna happen. I'm gonna say yeah, or no, I can't do it right now. And I got a family now. I'm gonna eat. No, we gonna eat. I used to let stuff go. I don't let nothing go. But watch this. Because I pay good money for my stuff I use for my business. I'm not finna give you the best I got because your mind said if I can't afford this. You gotta see the people. I just be nosy sometimes. Let's be realistic. They'll put their website up and I said, let me go and tap in and see what they look like. Man, that stuff be so jacked up, everything all out of order, pictures everywhere. But then you talking about excellence and being a leader in ministry and bringing people in to preach. Man, they ought to shut that mess down. Stop scratching yourself. Pay somebody to do something. Even me, if I want something done or somewhere that I can't get it right, I pick up the phone to me and say, hey, I want you to do this for me. Let me know what it costs. If people go give you something and you tell them you need something, somebody called me the other day, Well, it was a while ago. Brother Hubba, I like that logo you did. When I get some money, I want you to do me one. I said, which one are you talking about? That one, like such that. I went and did and gave it to him free. That's 200, not 200, that was $100 gone. It don't matter, because God said do it. Stop scratching yourself. You don't know what you'll get if you ask somebody. Then getting some and try to do it on your own and it look a mess. If you ain't no web designer, stop trying to design a web. Yeah, go down and put it up there. Anybody can do it, but then you got to have knowledge of that. Verse 14, for we scratch not ourselves beyond our measure, though we reach not unto you, for we are come as far to you also. Oh, I read that one. All right. Verse 15, not boasting of things without our measure, that is, of other man's labors, but having hope when your faith is increased, that we shall be enlarged by you accordingly to our rule abundantly. So Paul said, like I just explained, he said, we don't boast about things that we can't do. Not only that we don't boast things, we don't boast of other men's labor. Oh, Sister So went over there and it was a sold out crowd and she laid hands, she did. You don't do that. Paul said, don't do that. But having hope, when your faith is increased, that we shall be enlarged by you, which means if you let me teach you, if you let me mentor you, if you let me do this, then you'll be able to go out and do some things too. That's what Paul was saying. But y'all want to run around here. I went to the school of the Holy Spirit. All you do is sit on Facebook all day, type in scripture, and say God this and God that. Where your ministry at? If God called you to preach to reach others every year, you should add something to increase your ministry. The first, look, watch this. First thing I had was a website. Then I had a 1-800 number. Then God changed me around. I had another website. Then I did TV. Then I did radio. Then I bought this and this. Every year or every time I bought something to increase. You ain't going to tell me God called you to preach and what you use to market your ministry, expose your ministry, look like crap or you ain't got nothing. Told my wife the other day, I said, I got that website. I said, they be buying stuff. I said, but I don't even market that website. I said, let me redo it and put new stuff up there so I can market it. I'm paying for it. I got my personal website and I sell stuff on, and I got a website just for sale stuff on. If your ministry ain't costing you, man, you ain't ministering, you hustling. I remember one while, was it last year, year for last? I was spending maybe between $2,000 to $3,000 a month on stuff for ministry. But as people started leaving and started their own ministry, and I taught them that when the money went down. But I wasn't embarrassed. I still can hit this button and be on TV. I still can hit the button and have a radio show because God showed me when I paid for it also how to do it. Watch God. So I got the knowledge of that. And I just ain't had time to do it because I had to do everything. I had to find somebody around here who know how to do something. But until the end, I ain't finna overwork myself just to let people know I got some. 16. To preach the gospel in the region beyond you and not to boast in another man's line of things made ready to our hand. Paul's telling him again, he said, stop boasting about somebody else's ministry. You praising somebody else's ministry, I ain't saying nothing about yours. Don't be no fool. What you saying, Brother Hubba? Y'all around here try to make your ministry look like somebody else's ministry, so the reason your ministry ain't going because God didn't give you a ministry a comparison. He gave your ministry individuality, which means you supposed to do your ministry according to the revelation he gives you. You can't have no overseer, no covering, telling you what God told me to tell you to do this. When God gives a person the revelation to begin to go out here and minister, he gives you the whole detail. If you find somebody who can help you or you look up to, they should bring confirmation to what God told you. They shouldn't say, this how you need to do it. They can get suggestions. Y'all be blessed. Have a good day. La da 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 da.